गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, आई एम सुनील कुमार विश्वकर्मा, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, स्कूल ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग, बाबू बनारसी दास यूनिवर्सिटी, लखनऊ. टुडे इन दिस लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द कंसेप्ट ऑफ कंजेशन कंट्रोल. व्हाट आर द प्रिवेंशन टेक्निक्स और when the congestion occurs in the system, how it is detected and how it is removed from the system. So first of all, what is congestion? So if we talk about the internet, it can be considered as a queue of packets where transmitting nodes are constantly adding packets, and some of them we can say receiving nodes are removing packets from the queue. So consider a situation where too many packets are present in this queue, or we can say in the part of internet or in a part of internet, such that constantly transmitting nodes are pouring packets at a higher rate than receiving nodes are removing them. So this situation degrades the performance, and such a situation is termed as congestion. Okay, so congestion, here it is written, congestion is the situation in which too many packets are present in the subnet. Here in this graph, it is shown that x-axis represents the packets sent and the y-axis represents the packets delivered. And one horizontal dotted line is showing the maximum carrying capacity of the subnet or the part of the network. This is the maximum carrying capacity. So initially, what are the packets are sent, that is delivered successfully. So the line is a straight line. But after some time, when the packets are sent, the number of packets are sent is increased, but the delivery of the packets is down, or sometimes it is constant and after that it's down falls. So this situation is known as the congestion, but the desirable is this linear line is desirable, and the perfect situation is the whatever the capacity is, the maximum carrying capacity, that is the perfect line. Okay, so main reason of congestion is more number of packets in the network that it can handle. So the objective of congestion control can be summarized as to maintain the number of packets in the network below the level at which the performance falls off dramatically. The nature of packet switching network can be used in the following points: a network of queues at each node, there is a queue of packets for each outgoing channel. If packet arrival rate exceeds the packet transmission rate, the queue size grows without bound. When the line for which packets are queuing become more than 80% utilized, the queue length grows alarmingly. Okay, so when the number of packets dumped into the network is within the carrying capacity, they all are delivered except a few that have to be rejected due to transmission errors or due to anything else. But the number of delivered is proportional to the number of packets sent. However, as traffic increases too far, the routers are no longer able to cope and they begin to lose packets. So this situation tends to make matter worse. At very high traffic, the performance collapses completely, and almost no packet is delivered. Okay, so this is the congestion, and in this diagram it is shown the congestion situation. Now the causes of the congestion. The first cause, congestion occurs when a router receives data faster than it can send it. Okay, if router is not able to synchronize the speed, if it is receiving the data at different rate, or we can say at the faster rate, it is not sending at that rate, it is slower. So this can be due to the following reasons: the insufficient bandwidth, due to slow hosts, or due to data simultaneously arriving from multiple lines and they all destined for the same outgoing line. So these can be reasons for the congestion. Next is the system is not balanced. So correcting the problem at one router will probably just move the bottleneck to another router. Okay, so if the system is not balanced, if one router takes the corrective measures, so the router will move that bottleneck to the another router. Okay, so these are the congestion's causes. There are so many reasons. Slow processors, we have discussed. If the router CPU or process is slow at performing the task required for them, such as queuing buffers, updating tables, reporting any exceptions, so queue can build up even if there is excess of line capacity. Similarly, low bandwidth. And the major cause of congestion is often the bursty nature of traffic. If the host could be made to transmit at a uniform rate, then congestion problem will be less common. And all other causes will not even lead to congestion, because other causes just act as an enzyme which boosts up the congestion when the traffic is bursty. That is, other causes just add on the, make the problem more serious. Main cause is the bursty traffic. This means that when a device sends a packet and does not receive an acknowledgement from the receiver, in most of the cases, it can be assumed that the packets have been dropped by intermediate devices due to the congestion. So by detecting the rate at which segments are sent and not acknowledged, the source or an intermediate router can infer the level of congestion on the network. Okay. Now the effects of the congestion. Congestion affect two important parameters of the network performance. First parameter is throughput, and the second parameter is delay. And these parameters is shown in the figure. How throughput and offered load is shown in the first graph, and the another graph, average packet delay and the offered load graph is taken into account. Okay, so if we want to understand in simple terms, the throughput can be defined as the percentage utilization of the network capacity. What percentage of the network we are utilizing? Okay. So in this figure A, it is showing how throughput is affected as offered load increases. Initially, throughput increases linearly with offered load because utilization of the network increases. But as the offered load increases beyond certain limit, okay, say further 60% of the capacity of the network, the throughput drops. But if the offered load increases further, a point is reached when not a single packet is delivered to any destination, which is commonly known as the deadlock situation. Okay, it is shown in the figure. So there are three curves in the figure A. The ideal one corresponds to the situation when all the packets introduced are delivered to their destination up to the maximum capacity of the network. But the second one is corresponding to the situation and there is no congestion control. And the third one is the case when some congestion control technique is used. Okay. Now in the second graph, no matter what technique is used for congestion control, the delay grows without bound as the load approaches to the capacity of the system. It may be noted that initially there is longer delay when congestion control policy is applied. However, the network without any congestion control will saturate at a lower offered load. So this is the effect of the congestion. Now, congestion causes more congestion. Yes, this is true. Incoming messages must be placed in the queues. Reasons are the queues has finite size. So overflowing queues will cause packets to be dropped. Long queue delays will cause packets to be resent. Dropped packets will cause packets to be resent. Another point is sender that are trying to transmit to a congested destination also become congested. Due to the points are they must continually resend packets that have been dropped or that have been timed out. They must continue to hold outgoing or unacknowledged messages in memory. Okay. Now the congestion control versus flow control. Flow control controls point-to-point traffic between sender and receiver. For example, a fast host sending to a slow host. So there should not be a speed mismatch. Flow control is a mechanism which is used to manage the speed between the hosts. But the congestion is another situation. Congestion control controls the traffic throughput to the network. Okay. Now, two categories of congestion control. There are two categories of congestion control. One is open loop solutions and another is closed loop solutions. Open loop solutions attempt to prevent problems rather than correct them. And open loop solutions does not utilize runtime feedback from the system. Means open loop solutions are the prevention techniques. Open loop solutions tries to do not get the system congested. Or we can say these are the prevention techniques. But in closed loop solutions, there may be the possibility that system is congested and after that it is detected and the congestion is removed and the system is recovered from the congestion. So for this, it uses the feedback, means the measurements of the system performance, to make corrections at the runtime. So here in this hierarchical structure, it is shown that the congestion control techniques are of two types, open loop and the closed loop. Open loop is further classified into the source and the destination, and the closed loop is further classified into the explicit feedback and the implicit feedback. ओके नाउ द जनरल प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ क्लोज लूप कंजेशन कंट्रोल. मॉनिटर द सिस्टम टू डिटेक्ट व्हेन एंड वेयर कंजेशन अकर्स. इन क्लोज लूप कंजेशन कंट्रोल कंजेशन इज सिस्टम इज कंजेस्टेड एंड आफ्टर दैट इट इज रिकवर्ड आफ्टर डिटेक्शन. सो वॉट आर द स्टेप्स. द फर्स्ट स्टेप इज मॉनिटर द सिस्टम टू डिटेक्ट व्हेन एंड वेयर कंजेशन अकर्स. Pass this information to places where action can be taken and adjust the system operation to correct the problem. These are the points. These are the general principles of closed loop congestion control. Now the metrics used in the closed loop congestion control. What are the metrics used in the closed loop congestion control? One is percentage of packets discarded due to the buffer overflow. These are the parameters which is taken into account for the detection and the recovery of the congestion. So first one is percentage of packets discarded due to the buffer overflow. Buffer is this temporary storage area for storing the packets. Now the second is average queue length is another parameter. Third parameter is percentage of packets that time out. Next is average packet delay. What is the average packet delay? And the last one is standard deviation of packet delay. Okay. Reducing congestion. There are two methods. First one is increased resources and another is decreased traffic. Two techniques are used to reduce the congestion. What are the increased resources? Get additional bandwidth. Bandwidth is also a resource. When there will be additional bandwidth, it will reduce the congestion. So if we get the additional bandwidth, it uses faster lines, it obtains additional lines, it utilizes alternate pathway, and it utilizes the spare routers, the routers which are in spare. So these are the important points regarding increased resources, one of the method for reducing the congestion. Another method is decreased traffic. How we will decrease the traffic in the network? First point is send messages to the senders telling them to slow down. So this is the one of the technique through which sender is informed and it is told that do not send the packets in the same speed. Please slow down. In this way, we can decrease the traffic. Another technique is deny service to some users. Okay. And the third one is degrade service to some or all users. Denial of service is different and degrading service is different. Denial of service means you are not providing the service, and degrading service means you are providing service but not at the same pace. Now the next point is schedule uses to achieve better load balance. What is the uses? It is scheduled and using that achieve better load balance is achieved. Okay. Now one of the congestion control technique is leaky bucket algorithm. Here in this, there are two figures, figure A and figure B. Figure A is the leaky bucket. There is a bucket and there is a hole and it is leaking. The bucket is leaking. And the figure B is showing the leaky bucket implementation. So in this algorithm, a bucket is considered with a small hole at the bottom. Whatever may be the rate of water pouring into the bucket, but the rate at which water comes out from the small hole is constant. So this scenario is shown in the figure A. Once the bucket is full, any additional water entering it spills over the sides and it is lost. Okay, so the same idea of leaky bucket can be applied to the packets as shown in the figure B. So the conceptually each network interface contains a leaky bucket and some steps are performed. What are those steps? In the first step, when the host has to send a packet, the packet is thrown into the bucket. After that, the bucket leaks at a constant rate, meaning the network interface transmits packets at a constant rate. Okay. The third point is bursty traffic is converted to a uniform traffic by the leaky bucket. And the last point is, in practice, the bucket is a finite queue that outputs at a finite rate. So this arrangement can be simulated in the operating system or can be built into the hardware. So implementation of this algorithm is easy and consists of a finite queue. Whenever a packet arrives, if there is room in the queue, it is queued up. And if there is no room, then the packet is discarded. And this is the working of the leaky bucket algorithm. And this can be similarity with this leaky bucket. Now, the next algorithm is the token bucket algorithm. The leaky bucket algorithm enforces a rigid pattern at the output stream, irrespective of the pattern of the input. In many applications, it is better to allow the output to speed up somewhat when a large burst arrives than to lose the data. So, token bucket algorithm provides such a solution. In this algorithm, leaky bucket holds token, generates at regular intervals. Main steps of these algorithms are, in regular intervals, tokens are thrown into the bucket, is the same as the leaky bucket. In the second step, the bucket has a maximum capacity. If there is a ready packet, a token is removed from the bucket and the packet is sent. Okay. If there is no token in the bucket, the packet cannot be sent. Means for every packet, for every token, there is packet sent. So this figure 7.5.4a, in the A, figure A, token bucket holding two tokens before packets are sent out. In the B part, token bucket after two packets are sent and one packet still remains as no token is left in the bucket. So there are two situations which is shown in the diagram. So, the token bucket algorithm is less restrictive than the leaky bucket algorithms. in a sense that it allows bursty traffic. However, the limit of burst is restricted by the number of tokens available in the bucket at a particular instant of time. The implementation of basic bucket algorithm is simple. A variable is used just to count the token. The counter is incremented every t seconds and is decremented whenever a packet is sent. Whenever this counter reaches zero, no further packet is sent out, as shown in the figure 7.5.5. This is the implementation of the token bucket algorithm. So this is the count up for each tick, 1 to n. Add one token per tick, remove one token, and discard for each packet transmitted. So this is the whole situation, how the token bucket algorithm works. Thank you.